Good morning. It's great to see everyone here today to worship on this first Sunday in Lent. And we're going to be talking about, on the first Sunday of Lent, we're going to be talking about new beginnings. And we celebrated a new beginning earlier today where little Luke Mooney was brought to the waters of holy baptism at our 8 o'clock service. So it was just a wonderful, special celebration that we had. I also want to welcome everyone who's joining us online, whether you, if you're on Facebook, make sure to give a like to our feed and just share in the comments to let us know that you're worshiping with us today and where it is that you might be worshiping from. As we begin our worship this morning, let us go to the Lord in prayer. Heavenly Father, we thank you for this opportunity to gather together in worship here this morning. We pray that you would open our minds and open our hearts to that which you would do this morning in us and through us. Where we need a word of conviction, Lord, we pray that you would just speak that to our hearts. Where we need a word of encouragement or a word of grace, we pray that you would speak that to us as well. To you we give this next hour. We commend our time to you. And Lord, just to ask that you have your way with us. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Let's stand as we sing our opening song together. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Our help is in the name of the Lord. If you, O Lord, kept a record of sins, O Lord, who could stand?
But with you there is forgiveness, therefore you are here.
Since we are gathered to hear God's word, call upon him in prayer and praise, and receive the body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ in the fellowship of this altar. Let us first consider our unworthiness and confess before God and one another that we have sinned in thought, word, and deed, and that we cannot free ourselves from our sinful condition. Together as his people, let us take refuge in the infinite mercy of God, our Heavenly Father, seeking his grace for the sake of Christ and saying, God be merciful to me, a sinner. Almighty God, have mercy upon us. Forgive us our sins and lead us to everlasting life. Amen. Almighty God, merciful Father, in holy baptism, you declared us to be your children and gathered us into your one holy church in which you daily and richly forgive us our sins and grant us new life through your Spirit. Be in our midst, enliven our faith, and graciously receive our prayer and praise through your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. And please be seated, and at this time I want to invite our kids to come forward.
Do you know who died for me? Jesus. yes, he really did. Do you know who cares for me? Jesus does, Jesus does. Lovingly he cares for me. Yes, he really does.
All right. I want to invite you to come stand up here. I want you to come and look up here to see what you can see in here. What can you see? Water. You see water in here? Right. Do you know what this is?
The baptismal font.
It is the baptismal font. And we had a little baby this morning, baby Luke, that was baptized here. And we used the water that was in this font. Have you all been baptized? Yeah? Do you remember your baptism? No, probably not. A lot of us, we were probably baptized as babies. Some of us not, but a lot of us, we probably don't remember our baptisms. Now, in baptism, we use water, right? There's some water in this font. There's nothing really special about this water itself. The water that we use for baptisms can come from anywhere. It could come from a faucet. It could come from a lake. It could come from a river. It could come from the ocean. It could come from a swimming pool if we want. But what makes this water special is when the pastor or whoever is baptizing the child or the person says, I baptize you in the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. It is God's word that makes this water to be special, the water and the word together. Now, we're going to do something special here today to remember our baptism, because it's important for us to always remember our baptism, because that's where God made us to be a part of his family. And we always want to remember that we are a child of God. So what we're going to do, we're going to take three fingers. Okay, one, two, three. Why do you think I take three fingers?
For the Father, the Son, and Holy Spirit.
You got it. Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. So three fingers, and don't do this yet, but what we're going to do is, because you are baptized in the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, we're going to take three fingers and we're going to dip that into the water. All right? And then what we're going to do is we're going to make the sign of the cross, because that's a sign that shows that God loves us. And what we're going to do is we're going to start with our head right here. So take the three fingers, we'll put them on our head. And that's where we learn, we hear with our ears that God loves us. And we come to know in our mind that God loves us. It's something that we come to know. But we want it to be something more than we know, but it's also something we believe, right? So from our head to our heart, that God loves us, Jesus died for us, and that we are his child. And then what we're going to do is we're going to go from shoulder to shoulder, that God's love carries throughout our entire life from the beginning to the end, all the way across our life, in all of the different places that we go, whether we're at home, whether at school, or whether we're at the playground. So from our head to our heart throughout our whole life. Think you can do that with me? Let's try that. So three fingers. We'll dip it in the water just to remember our baptisms. And then you make the sign of the cross. Head to heart, shoulder to shoulder. God loves you and you are his child. Yeah, if you want a nap, if you want a towel to wipe your hands. And here's what I'm going to do, too, for all of our big kids here. If you want to, also, as you come forward to receive the Lord's Supper this morning, we're going to leave the top off the baptismal font and invite you, if you want to recall your baptism, to know that God loves you, to make the sign of the cross with the waters from the baptismal font. Invite you to have that opportunity to do so this morning. Let's pray, fold our hands, bow our heads, and if everyone will repeat after me. Dear Jesus,
thank you
for loving us
with the greatest love possible.
Thank you for our baptisms to always know
we are a child of God,
greatly loved.
No matter what.
Amen. All right, great. You can head back to your seats now. Our service continues with the reading of the Old Testament lesson from Genesis chapter 22, starting at the first verse. After these things, God tested Abraham and said to him, "Abraham," and he said, "Here I am." He said, "Take your son, your only son Isaac, whom you love, and go to the land of Moriah and offer him there as a burnt offering on one of the mountains of which I shall tell you." So Abraham rose early in the morning, saddled his donkey, and took his two young men with him and his son Isaac. And he cut the wood for the burnt offering and arose and went to the place of which God had told him. On the third day, Abraham lifted up his eyes and saw the place from afar. Then Abraham said to his young men, "Stay here with the donkey. I and the boy will go over there and worship and come again to you." And Abraham took the wood of the burnt offering and laid it on Isaac his son. And he took it in his hand the fire, and the knife. And so they went both of them together. And Isaac said to his father, "Abraham, my father." And he said, "Here I am, my son." He said, "Behold the fire and the wood, but where is the lamb for the burnt offering?" Abraham said, "God will provide for himself the lamb for the burnt offering, my son." So they went both of them together. When they came to the place of which God had told him, Abraham built the altar there and laid the wood in order and bound Isaac his son and laid him on the altar on top of the wood. Abraham reached out his hand and took the knife to slaughter his son. But the angel of the Lord called to him from heaven and said, "Abraham, Abraham." And he said, "Here I am." He said, "Do not lay your hand on the boy or do anything to him. For now I know that you fear God, seeing that you have not withheld your son, your only son, from me." And Abraham lifted up his eyes and looked, and behold, behind him was a ram caught in a thicket by the horns. And Abraham went and took the ram and offered it up as a burnt offering instead of his son. So Abraham called the name of that place, "The Lord will provide." As it is said to this day, on the mount of the Lord, it shall be provided. The angel of the Lord called to Abraham a second time from heaven and said, "By myself I have sworn, declares the Lord, because you have done this and have not withheld your son, your only son, I will surely bless you, and I will surely multiply your offspring as the stars in heaven and as the sand that is on the seashore. And your offspring shall possess the gate of his enemies. And in your offspring shall all nations of the earth be blessed, because you have obeyed my voice." This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Our epistle lesson is from James chapter 1, starting at the 12th verse. "Blessed is the man who remains steadfast under trial, for when he has stood the test, he will receive the crown of life, which God has promised to those who love him. Let no one say when he is tempted, 'I am being tempted by God,' for God cannot be tempted with evil, and he himself tempts no one. But each person is tempted when he is lured and enticed by his own desire. Then desire, when it has conceived, gives birth to sin, and sin, when it is fully grown, brings forth death. Do not be deceived, my beloved brothers. Every good gift and every perfect gift is from above, coming down from the Father of lights, with whom there is no variation or shadow due to change. Of his own will he brought us forth by the word of truth, that we should be a kind of first fruits of his creatures." This is the word of the Lord. We stand for the reading of the Holy Gospel. The Holy Gospel is written in the first chapter of St. Mark, beginning at the 9th verse. "In those days, Jesus came from Nazareth of Galilee and was baptized by John in the Jordan. And when he came up out of the water, immediately he saw the heavens being torn open and the Spirit descending on him like a dove. And a voice came from heaven, 'You are my beloved Son, with you I am well pleased.' The Spirit immediately drove him out into the wilderness. And he was in the wilderness 40 days being tempted by Satan. And he was with the wild animals, and the angels were ministering to him. Now after John was arrested, Jesus came into Galilee proclaiming the gospel of God and saying, 'The time is fulfilled and the kingdom of God is at hand. Repent and believe in the gospel.' This is the gospel of our Lord." And we confess our faith using the words of the Apostles' Creed. "I believe in God, the Father Almighty,
maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate,
Please be seated.
He became sin who knew no sin, that we might become his righteousness. He humbled himself and carried the cross. Love so amazing. Love so amazing. Jesus Messiah, name above.
First Sunday in Lent. Lent is a 40-day journey that culminates, of course, with the celebration of the resurrection of Jesus Christ. Sundays are always interesting. They're Sundays not of Lent, but they are Sundays in Lent. Sundays are not counted towards those 40 days. A season is often a season of fasting, of practicing the spiritual disciplines, and we do those things, those 6 days of the week, and then Sunday, it's a day for gathering together as the people of God and celebrating the things that God is doing in us and through us. That word Lent, it's a funny word. You think about it, some of these different seasons, they're all kind of funny words. Advent, Epiphany, Lent. Well, what does Lent mean? Anyone know what Lent means? In trivia pursuit here, Lent literally is translated spring. It's not all that complex. It's not all that difficult. Lent equals spring. The season of spring, it's about new beginnings. We may not be able to fully appreciate spring here in Florida, but you go up north and you get to this time of the year at the end of February, and everyone is just waiting for winter to be over and can't wait for the spring to begin. Spring is about new life. The trees begin to bud, the flowers come forth. It is a new beginning, and this Lent, it is a season of new beginnings. And how appropriate that I would come here at this time of the year during the season of Lent as we make a new beginning together. Our God, he is a God of new beginnings. 2 Corinthians 5, verse 17 is a verse that epitomizes this. It says, therefore, if anyone is in Christ, that he is what? He is a new creation. The old has gone, the new, it has come. But many of us, we may not feel much like a new beginning. Many of us may feel as if we are adrift. And the reason that is because our culture is adrift. And if you drift long enough, the thing is that you're going to drift nowhere good. A couple of months ago, when I was up in Jersey, I was a boat offshore. It lost its engines and it began to drift, and eventually, just like this boat, it drifted ashore, it washed up, and it went aground on the beach. And the waves started beating against the boat, and the boat eventually broke apart and sunk into the ocean. Maybe you feel like you're drifting. Maybe you feel like you're stuck. Maybe you feel like you've gone aground. We live in a consumeristic culture. We consume material things. Months ago, I began downsizing, minimalizing the things that I have. And still, as much as I threw away, as much as I sold, it still seems like I brought so much here to Florida with me, and we're still throwing things out, and we're still selling things. Americans, we have a way of collecting stuff, more things than we need. We are also consumers not just of things, but we are consumers of experiences, whether it is entertainment on television, social media on our phones. You know, they thought that when we got these phones and they came out with social media, things like Facebook and Twitter and Instagram, that we would spend less time on traditional television media because we're spending more times on this thing. But they came to discover through doing the research that most Americans, even though they spend hours and hours on these things, that they're spending just as many hours as they used to watching television as well. So we continue to consume and consume, whether it's television, whether it's sports, whether it's vacations. And we carry that over into many different aspects of our life. We carry that over into our religious part of our life as well. We become, as Americans, consumers of religious services. And so we might attend church. We come to receive the Lord's Supper. We take in and we consume, but we fail to give of our time, our treasure, and our talents. The thing is, if all we are is consumers, and there's this great push in our culture to be a culture of consumers, we're never going to find fulfillment in that. Some of the richest people in the world who have the most things are some of the saddest people in the world because they've collected and they've accumulated all this stuff and they've discovered that it was not all they thought it would be and that there must be more, but they don't know what that more is because they don't know, ultimately, they don't know Jesus. To find fulfillment in life is about walking in step with Jesus as he calls us to join him in his mission. And the connection point starts with the Word of God. Mark 1 verse 1 wasn't part of our gospel reading, but it came right before. The beginning of the gospel of Jesus Christ, the Son of God. He states that in the very first verse, and it's not like Mark is saying here, chapter 1, verse 1, this is the beginning of the gospel, and we're going to get to Mark 16, the last chapter, and the very last verse is going to say this is the end of the gospel and it's all over. This is the beginning of the gospel in the life, the death, the resurrection of Jesus, the story of Jesus, the great extent of God's love shown through Jesus is told to us in the gospel of Mark, but the gospel of Mark does not end the gospel story. We think about history, right? Have you ever thought about the two words that you find in the word history? It is his story. It is God's story of creation, the fall, the redemption, And it will all come to the culmination when Jesus returns in all of his glory. The beginning of the gospel, it starts with Jesus, but it doesn't end necessarily with Jesus. It continues in my life and your life in history. The gospel message is playing out here today, and we get to be participants in that together, you and me. And the connection is made in our baptisms. In those days, Jesus came from Nazareth in Galilee and was baptized by John in the Jordan. I had the kids up here, and we remembered our baptism. We had little Luke that was baptized. Our baptism is something special because it makes us to be part of God's family. Romans chapter 6 says this: "Do you not know that all of us who are baptized into Christ Jesus were baptized into his death?" In other words, we are associated with Jesus. We are connected with Jesus. As he is the Son of God, through baptism, we become sons and daughters of God. We were buried, therefore, with him by baptism into death. We associate with the death that he died, in order that just as Christ was raised from the dead by the glory of the Father, we too might walk in, right there, that's that word we've been talking about this morning, new beginnings, the newness of life. For if we have been united with him in a death like his, we shall certainly be united with him in a resurrection like his. The thing is, those of us who are parents, you love your children, right? I'm going to make that assumption. You love your children. Now, why do you love your children? Do you love your children because they are perfect? No. You know quite well your children are far from perfect. Do you love your children because of the things that they do or that they don't do? Certainly, indeed, there are times when your children make you proud. Yet, there are those times where they disappoint you. You as a parent do not love your children because they are perfect. You as a parent do not love your children because of the things that they do or they don't do. The reason that you love your children is because of who they are. You love your children because they are your children. And it's in the same way, that's what we are reminded of in our baptism, that God loves us. In this heavenly washing, we are adopted into God's family. And now from that point forward, God makes a promise that he loves you, not because you're perfect. All of us, we are far from perfect. He loves you not because of the things you do or the things that you don't do. He loves you because of who you are and who you were made to be through Jesus' sacrifice upon the cross in this heavenly washing, adopted into his family as one of his own. If you feel like you're adrift, you feel like you are stuck, go back to the promise made into your baptism and recognize that you are God's child, and he promises along the way, wherever it might be in this journey of life, that he will help you out, just as we as parents help out our children. And when Jesus came up out of the water, immediately it says, he saw the heavens being torn open and the Spirit descending upon him like a dove. And the way God helps us out is through his Holy Spirit. It is the Spirit that is promised to us in our baptism. And it is the Spirit who empowers us to live holy lives. It is the Holy Spirit who empowers us to say yes to the things that God would have us say yes to and no to the things that he would have us say no to. It is the Holy Spirit who empowers us to do things that otherwise we would be incapable of doing. It says in the book of Romans, if God is for us, who can be against us? When the Spirit of God is in your life, he will direct your steps. So remember, if you're looking, if you're stuck, if you're feeling adrift, start with your baptism. Recognize the promise of the Holy Spirit and ask for God to give you a fuller, a richer measure of the Holy Spirit in your life to live fully equipped and empowered by him. The Spirit, then it says, immediately drove Jesus out into the wilderness. Here's the thing. Life moves fast. Mark, this is one of Mark's favorite words, immediately. Jesus is seemingly going from one experience to the next. The Gospel of Mark reads really fast. It's 16 short chapters. And it's amazingly quick that you go from the beginning of the gospel to the crucifixion to the resurrection to Jesus sending out his disciples. I think you would agree with me that life moves fast. It's crazy. I think about this last year. Christine's missing worship today. She went out to the car this morning, and the car had a flat tire. So I'm missing her here this morning. But it's been amazing the journey that God has had us on this last year. And I think about where we've come since last year at this time, the last time we celebrated her birthday. Last summer, I moved her from Illinois to New Jersey, and we got married. And at that time, we could have hardly imagined that we'd be moving just a few months later from then New Jersey now to Florida. From one thing to the next. Life moves fast, and you never know. And is the Spirit leading? You never know where the Spirit is going to lead. And sometimes it's into difficult places that you would have never otherwise ventured, but God's got you there for a reason. And sometimes it's to amazing places and amazing adventures that you would have never taken on your own. Jesus says, do not be anxious about tomorrow. I don't know what tomorrow is going to bring. I don't even know what the rest of today is going to bring. For tomorrow has enough anxiousness of itself. Sufficient for the day is its own trouble. What Jesus is saying here, focus on the here, the right now, where God has got us. Some of us are adrift and we are stuck because we're stuck in our past. We're looking back, and there are those past regrets, those past mistakes, those hang-ups that got us, and we're living with such regret that it is hindering our present lives. Here's the thing that you need to know, that your past does not equal your future. Certainly, indeed, you can learn from your past, those mistakes, those regrets that you have, but you don't need to live in your past. God has created you for today. Today is the day the Lord has made, and we will rejoice in today and be glad in it. Don't go back to the past, because you can't go back to the past. Live here, now, today, this moment. Some of us, we can be so future-focused that we miss out on the blessings and the things that God is doing today. We think to ourselves, only if one day when I get out of debt, only if one day when I find the right person and I marry the right person, only if one day when I get that raise or I get that job, and we're waiting and we're waiting and we're waiting and we're waiting our life away. In the meantime, failing to recognize and see the amazing opportunities and the things that God is doing in our life today. I want to encourage you to keep a gratitude journal. Just take five things every day, whether at the beginning of your day or at the end of the day, just to consider five things to be thankful for today, things that where you saw God at work and evident in your life. Don't miss out by looking in the past or looking in the future, but look right now, right here, what God is doing. Verse 13, and he was in the wilderness 40 days, Jesus, being tempted by Satan. And he was with the wild animals, and the angels were ministering to him. Find it interesting that the Holy Spirit drove Jesus into the wilderness, and it was there in the wilderness that he was tempted by Satan. Yeah, you may feel adrift, you may feel stuck, you may feel like you are in the wilderness. I shared this before with you. In this world, Jesus promises you will have trouble, but he continues that promise by saying, take heart, I have overcome this world. Life is filled with challenges, and anything that is worth doing, I guarantee you, is going to be hard. If you are not under constant attack, undergoing spiritual warfare, it is very likely that you're sitting over here off on the sidelines as opposed to standing on the front lines of advancing the kingdom of God. If we are doing anything that is worthwhile doing for the sake of the kingdom, Satan will attack. It's going to be challenging. It's going to be difficult. And if we realize up front how difficult it might have been, we might not have ever undertook it in the first place. Think about some of the most amazing accomplishments that you've had in your life, the things that you look back that you were proud of. And I imagine that if you recognize the reason that you are proud of it is because it was hard. It was difficult, but you persevered with the help of God and the Holy Spirit. You persevered through those challenging times, and God was able to do something amazing in you and through you. Know that the challenges in life are there, but it is the challenges that mean that we're doing something worthwhile. Mark 1, 14, verse 15. I end with this. After John was arrested, Jesus came into Galilee, proclaiming the gospel of God and saying, "The time is fulfilled. The kingdom of God is at hand. Repent and believe the gospel." Those two last words there, repent and believe. The power of repentance and the power of belief. You may feel stuck. You may feel adrift. But Jesus calls us to repentance. And repentance is about more than stop doing bad things. Repentance is a change of mind. It is a change of heart. It is about changing the way that I am living. It is about changing the things that I am doing. It's about doing different. And having that belief that your past does not equal your future. That God can and will do different in your life. That you don't have to settle. That whether you feel that you're in bondage to some addiction, whether it may be a health challenge that you are facing, God is able. He is more than able. His disciples asked Jesus, how is this possible? And Jesus said, with God, all things are possible. It doesn't matter how long you've been stuck. It doesn't matter how long you have been adrift. Today is a new day. And we have an amazing God who is more than able that we serve. He is the creator. He is the owner of all things. He holds all things in his hands. And he will empower you. He will equip you. He will enable you. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you through Jesus Christ. We thank you, Lord, for this life that you have given to us, the calling that you've placed upon our lives to serve you and to make a difference in the lives of others. Lord, today, some of us here, we may feel stuck. We may feel adrift. We may feel as if, Lord, we've been set on the sidelines. We may feel, Lord, that the situation that we are in is an impossible situation. Lord, but you call us today to repentance and belief. You call us to a new beginning. You call us to a new start. Help us to recognize in our baptisms that you love us in a tremendous way, that you are faithful to all your promises, and that you will never let us down. Give us, Lord, a rich measure of your Holy Spirit. Empower us with wisdom. Empower us with your strength to live fully and completely surrendered to you. In Jesus' name we pray, and all God's people said, amen. Let's continue now our worship as we bring our tithes and our offerings unto him. Please stand. And we pray for the whole people of God in Christ Jesus and for all people according to their needs. Oh Lord, in the midst of this life, we are faced by many temptations. Help us to fix our eyes on our Lord Jesus, who bore temptation for us and resisted to the point of death. And bring us through the evils of this fallen world to dwell with you forever. Lord, in your mercy. Lord, you placed the wood of the cross on the back of your only begotten Son, that as the promised offspring of Abraham, he might possess the gates of hell. Bless, we pray, your church and all those who serve within her. Give them certainty that hell cannot prevail against them, and so embolden them in faith to trample every power of the enemy underfoot. Make us bold in our witness to proclaim the gospel unashamed in both word and deed. Lord, in your mercy. Almighty God, preserve all students and their teachers. We pray especially for Emmanuel Lutheran School. We pray that it would be a place of great learning and where the love, compassion, and forgiveness of Jesus is practiced. We pray for every Christian home to be a place where the faith is nurtured and that the love of Jesus is evident. Lord, in your mercy. Father of lights, from whom every good and perfect gift comes down to us from above, keep us from being enticed by our own selfish desires to misuse your gifts. Help us use our time, our treasure, our talents rightly as good stewards in service to you and our neighbor. Lord, in your mercy. Most high God, our refuge in every trouble, you have promised to hear when we call you. We pray especially today for friends and family members and acquaintances who suffer. We pray, Lord, today especially for Bill Anton and Joan Krause as they recover from COVID. We also pray for continued healing from knee surgery for Diane Ritter. We pray also, Lord, for all of those others we name upon our hearts. Keep them from every evil that can befall the body, mind, or soul. Lord, in your mercy. And it's into your hands, Lord, we commend all of this for which we pray, trusting in your mercy through Jesus Christ, our Lord, our Savior, who's taught us to pray, Our Father,
who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
Our Lord Jesus Christ, it was on the night in which he was betrayed that he took bread. And when he had given thanks, he broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, Take, eat. This is my body given for you. This do in remembrance of me. In the same way also, after the supper, our Lord took the cup. And when he had given thanks, he gave it to his disciples, saying, Take, drink. This cup is the new covenant in my blood, shed for you for the forgiveness of all your sins. This do as often as you drink it in remembrance of me. The peace of the Lord be with you always. We share the peace of the Lord with one another.
I love you, Lord,
Please stand. Now may the body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ strengthen and preserve you in body and soul to life everlasting. Depart in peace. Receive now the Lord's blessing. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord look upon you with his favor and give you his peace. Amen.
The splendor of the King, clothed in majesty, let all the earth rejoice, let all the earth rejoice. He wraps himself in light, and darkness tries to hide, and trembles at his voice, and trembles at his voice. How great is our God! Sing with me, how great is our God, and all will see how great is our God. And age to age he stands, and time is in his hands, beginning and the end, beginning and the end. The Godhead three in one, Father, Spirit, Son, the Lion and the Lamb, the Lion and the Lamb. How great is our God! Sing with me, how great is our God, and all will see how great is our God.
Couple of announcements that we have this morning. If you would please be seated for a moment.
Hi, I just wanted to let everybody know just a few weeks from now that we'll have our third spring into 2024 5K. And I want to let everybody know no one has to do 5K. That's just what we call it. And you can walk, you can run, you can jog, you can ride your bike, and you do not have to go 5K. And it will be our third annual, and it will be on March 3rd, 2024. And we'll have sign-ups and stuff coming out in email, and we'll have somebody with all the flyers next week. Hope to see you there. Thank you.
And also a reminder that this Wednesday is our midweek Lent service starting at 6:30, and we have a dinner before that starting at 5:30. There's also an insert in your worship folder today on Monday, February 26th, 2 weeks on 6:30. There will be a special call meeting to call a principal for Emmanuel Lutheran School. And let's stand to speak our vision. As a reminder of the reason why we exist as a church, let us speak our vision statement together. Through word and sacrament ministry, we share the love, joy, and peace of Jesus Christ among ourselves and with those around us. Our worship has ended. Our service now begins. Let us go in peace and serve the Lord. Thanks be to God.